Yay. I can see someone at the back waving. Okay, hi everybody. Welcome to your session with Sofia. Say your surname for me.
Calderia.
There you go. I did not want to do that. Sofia will be speaking about her role at the third floor. She's a layout and previs artist, so she's going to be talking all about that today. You guys will leave this event with a better understanding of both a layout, both roles of a layout artist and I've written a layout artist and a layout artist.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, that thing twice. And also how to join and succeed in the VFX industry. So it sounds like a really exciting talk. I know you've heard it a million times, but if there's a fire alarm or anything like that, then just head out onto Brook Street, which is behind Metronome. We haven't had any fire alarms this week so far, so we're doing okay. I hope you enjoy your talks this week. You've had quite a few really good ones already. Sophia's is going to be amazing. We've got Hugo and Victor tomorrow, so quite a big end to the week. Remember to hashtag IW22 and you might win £50 Amazon voucher. That's pretty much it from me. So yeah, enjoy the talk. I'm going to hand over now if we can just give Sophia a round of applause for coming. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I hope you are all having an amazing Industry Week 2022. My name is Sofia, and it's my absolute pleasure to be here today. Today I'll be talking about my journey in the industry as a layout and previs artist, both in animation and visual effects, and tell you how I got my first job, and I'll end as well with some tips and advice for all of you who will soon be joining the industry. So bear with me, I have loads to tell you, but I hope you enjoy it and that you learn something new. So first, let's rewind a bit for my background. Once you join the industry, you'll work with people from all over the world, different backgrounds, different walks of lives, and mine is certainly different than yours. Sometimes the road to our dreams and to success is not a straight line, actually, it rarely is. So it's okay to take a bit longer to get there. It's okay to have to do some U-turns, to do some different choices. But the important thing is that every time you surpass a challenge or learn something new, these are life skills that you are putting on your utility belt, and in the future you'll end up using them. So nothing is actually wasted. So I'm from the beautiful city of Porto in the north of Portugal. If you've recently watched The Suicide Squad, it's the pretty city you'll see on the sweet moment between Ratcatcher 2 and her father on the top of the tower. No, you can't go there up into the tower. I know you were thinking about it, but there's other beautiful spots for views. If you want to go, just give me a shout. And as I was growing up, I've always been a creative person, but I really didn't know which career path I wanted to take. And when I was around my secondary education, my parents bought a DVD player. And what some of you might not know about the golden era of DVD is that they really put an effort doing them. It will come with hours and hours of extra material, behind the scenes, extra scenes, sometimes games that you would play with a remote. It was crazy. And because there was no streaming services at the time, I would spend hours watching them. So I saw those people behind the cameras and I thought for myself, this looked like fun. Maybe I should study something related to filmmaking. And that's what I did. I joined uni to study audiovisual and multimedia technology. Let me tell you guys, this was some of the most creative years of my life. I've learned loads, I've experimented a lot. So now that you are students, cherish this time, because now is the time to take risks on your projects. And it will absolutely pay off, so do it. So I learned things like developing film photography, but we also would grab our cameras and go downtown, film our short films, our experimental projects. And I also learned 3D animation during this time, and I fell in love with the medium. Of course, I've been a Pixar fangirl since the first time I saw Toy Story 1, but I didn't know that if you install the software on a computer, you can actually start doing your own things. I thought it was something way more complex than that. So I really, really wanted to focus my energy on that. So after I graduated, and let me show you, this is how we graduate in Porto. So a top hat, a cane, and a big parade downtown, bottle of port wine never too far from us, it's crazy times. So after I graduated, I moved to London. I've been to London twice before, really, really loved it, and I really wanted to work on the film industry. And in Europe, what better place to go if not London, right? However, I got a bit of a shock when I started applying to visual effects studios and animation studios, because my skills were short of what they were requiring. Even today, they are very specific skills, department focus, and I was not there at the time, so I got a bit lost. I've worked, still did some other things. I've worked as a digital designer freelance and working mostly for clients in Portugal. I work full-time in other jobs to pay my bills. I ended up working 1 year and a half as a studio photographer, and this was really fun, but it wasn't the reason why I had moved to the UK in the first place. So I decided to give 3D another shot. And that's when I enrolled at Escape Studios to do an intensive 4 month course called Advanced 3D for Visual Effects. So the course is very much tailored to the industry, such as the ones you guys study here, but of course mine was very compact because it was 4 months. And it gave realistic expectations of the skills that the industry requires and what softwares you have to learn. And I learned loads of the steps of the pipeline, so then I could work on my personal projects and decide which department I wanted to focus my energy in. I actually got employed by Escape Studios after I finished the course. I worked as part of the student experience, which was great because after my shift, I could stay there and work on the machines that were way better than mine at home. But if you ever have to go through this, guys, of working full-time and still going home and working on your stuff, I see you and I feel you because it's really hard. It's very easy to start losing motivation. It's very easy to start thinking your stuff is not good enough. You start getting overwhelmed because you hear about these new softwares and tools coming into the industry, and you start thinking you need to learn everything because then you never get a job if you don't put everything on your showreel. And if you get stuck in this loop, you may start losing opportunities. Like I almost lost my first one. And now I'm going to tell you the story of how I got started in the industry. So I have a friend working at MPC, and he told me, Sofia, MPC is looking for layout artists, you should apply. And I had two reactions. First one was like my showreel is good enough to apply to MPC. It's one of the four big studios of visual effects in London. There's no way. And my second reaction is, what is layout? What do layout artists do? So to save you from searching that, I compact some information to put it very easily. Layout artists establish camera positions, camera movements, and character blocking to build editorial sequences that will be used by all of the other departments as a foundation for short construction. So every other department will build upon layout, and before layout there was no shot in the pipeline. Before there was plates, there was loose assets, and we are the first department that actually assembles the shot. If you start job hunting for layout, you might hear some different terms of some roles that might overlap but are actually different. So for example, in animation you have rough layout and final layout. Rough layout starts early on the pre-production stage and is literally the translation of storyboards into 3D sequence. They set the beat of the scene and they design the virtual cinematography by creating the camera moves and choosing the lenses. One might even say that in 3D animation, rough layout is actually the filmmaking part of it. Final layout is a bit different. They are responsible for placing the animated characters in the scenes, set dressing the shots, adjust the camera movements, and ensuring continuity between shots and sequences. And I'm not going to underline this part because you really need to have an eagle eye to spot any inconsistencies on the CG between the shots. It's really part of your role. In visual effects, you won't hear about rough layout, but there is a department that does something very similar, and it's called previsualization. Although please note that the aim of previsualization is to choreograph complex action scenes, or not CG-heavy scenes, to then make them easier to a film. But very often you will see the final shot in the film, and it's very similar, if not almost the same, as the concept that was created in previs. In layout, in a visual effects studio, is very similar to final layout. But please note that some studios have the match move department inside of layout, so you would have to track your shots. Not at MPC, though, but some studios also have that in mind. So after understanding this, I was still not sure if I should apply. I really didn't thought it was good enough, my showreel. But my friend actually believed in me more than I believed in myself, and he was very insistent. So I stopped for a moment and I thought, because my showreel was mostly 3D generalist, like I know how to work in Maya and other softwares. I actually have a background in photography. I know how real life cameras work, and it's so important in layout to understand how cameras work. So I'll give it a shot. So I reached out to the recruiter on LinkedIn. She was the one who posted the job. And I've asked if she was still looking for artists or if she already filled the positions. She was really nice and she asked for my show reel. I sent it. 1 or 2 days later, they invited me for an interview. I went, it was all right. And on the same day, they offered me the position. And this is me. Very happy at the end of my first day of work with my MPC tote bag because I finally got my first foot in the industry and I was so happy I was doing it. But if I was still trying to make my perfect showreel that was in my mind happen, I would have missed that opportunity and many others. So be aware, guys, there's no such thing as a perfect showreel. Of course, everything you have to have there has to be to a very high standard, but just have those pieces on a showreel ready to send in case these opportunities come along. So now I'm at MPC, and the first film I worked on was the one and only Ivan. And I couldn't have asked for a better start. I had an amazing team. We were about 10 when I started, and I had a super supportive lead. She was one of those leads that know the strongest skills of each team member, and she will take that in consideration when assigning shots. So it was a very, very good start for me. And back to the film, who here has watched the one and only Ivan? No one, great. It's on Disney Plus, if you guys are feeling curious. And the film is based on the book with the same name that is in turn based on the real life story of Ivan the gorilla that lived alone for 27 years on a mole in the United States. Yeah, it's really sad, but it did have a happy ending. He would move to a more suitable habitat on the last years of his life, but he was known for drawing and watching TV on his enclosure. So the book has those elements. And some others in the film and in the book, they actually perform on a little circus inside of the mall. So what I'm going to show you now is the trailer, because nobody has watched it, so you guys can see how it looks like and then discuss a little bit of details about it.
Welcome to your new home.
We hear rolling. What are you looking at? Your papa.
Looking at his dad.
Let's give him a great show, okay?
The one and only.
Why do they want an angry gorilla anyway?
You're a silverback. He terrifies humans.
You're not terrifying. Who's that?
My sister.
Where's your sister now?
I don't remember.
Memories never leave us. They just get out of reach.
Whoa, did you draw all these?
A gorilla.
Who draws?
What is it? Don't tell me, don't tell me.
It's a lonely haystack on a late summer day.
It's a beetle.
Can you tell me a story?
Once there was a baby elephant who was smart and brave, and she needed to live in the wild where she could be free.
Ivan!
Does the baby elephant get to be free?
Clearly a sign he wants to be free.
What about Mac? He's taken care of me my whole life.
We're family. We're in this together.
I'll just cross the road then.
Why would you cross the road?
To get to the other side.
Okay, so I know the talking might have given it away, but the animals are CG, okay? MPC did a great job with the characters. There were 9 different animal characters on the film. And they are known for their work on creatures. Think Lion King, Jungle Book, Godzilla versus King Kong, Godzilla King of the Monsters. NPC has in-house tools for fur and feathers. They actually have, within the assets department, their character lab, that is a group of people just focused on creating and developing high-end creatures for TV and film. But not only did they do a great job on the assets, animation did a really good job with the choice of animation. Because when you have realistic animals that talk and have emotions, it's very easy to cross that uncanny valley line. Not necessarily with a gorilla because it's so similar to us, but with an elephant or a dog or a chicken, you have to be very careful on the choices you make, and I think they really did a good job. Now, I've told you the animals were CG, but something that you might not have noticed is every time the animals are on their own, everything around them is CG as well. So this shot right here, 100% CG shot. Everything that's on the backstage that they are on their own, the living quarters, is also 100% CG. They copy the real life set detail by detail. And we're talking about a complex environment full of reflective surfaces, metals, glass, water, semi-transparent tiles, all of that was taken into consideration. And I can assure you, you won't be able to notice the difference between a plate and a CG environment. It's just like for like. And that's the beauty of visual effects, right? The film was actually filmed in two stages, and actually two parts. The first one was on the set and on location with the actors, with some stuffies instead of the animals to solve the eyeline problem. But the second half was done on a virtual production stage with the real-life crew. This was a choice because there was pages and pages of the script where the animals were just talking to each other and interacting with each other. And if they would have gone old school of going to the sets and filming empty plates, you would have been stuck to those plates, while virtual production offers a lot of flexibility in posts, so you can try different things in animation as well. In layout, we would work with both. So every time we received a plate, we would put there the CG characters. And when we had the visual production, we would work a little bit different. We would have the cameras from the visual production shots, so we would preserve the filmmaker's vision, but we would often receive notes to refine them or to try something completely different. And we could, because it was everything 100% CG. And those were by far my favorite shots to work on. As soon as we start seeing some renders from lighting, we knew we were working on something special here because it was looking amazing. The director was impressed, the bosses at Disney were impressed. Even Danny DeVito, the voices, the dog, was impressed. He would come to NPC to watch some dailies sometimes. I never saw him, but people told me that he was in the building, so bad luck to me. So we were really excited to watch this on a big screen, but a little thing called COVID hit, and it went straight to streaming. With that, our hopes and dreams of having the film qualified for some awards, because some award shows, you have to have a cinema release to be eligible. However, by the end of 2020, the award shows noticed that not many films had cinema releases, so they opened an exception. If the film had a planned one, but couldn't because of restrictions, they would be able to qualify, so we were back in the game. The one and only Ivan was shortlisted, nominated, and won some awards. And what I'm going to show you next is a showreel that the visual effects supervisors were showing the voters on their awards campaign.
Still be that.
Why do they want an angry gorilla anyway?
I think humans like us one way.
I'm very scary. So, run along.
before I start thumping and roaring with rage.
It's too bad you can't have it all. You can have freedom, but you gotta live by your wits with no security. Or you can have security, but you're stuck in a cage all day doing tricks for humans. It's a tough call. There's a difference between can't remember and won't remember.
I used to think, if I learn how to fight, and drawing in the mud, I could have.
So 500 artists around the world worked on the various NPC studios to make this film. And after the awards campaign, we were nominated for an Oscar and for a BAFTA, which was a huge, huge honor for us. Unfortunately, we lost to Tenet. But we still won the Hollywood Post Alliance Award for Outstanding Visual Effects in Feature Film, and the Visual Effects Society Award for Outstanding Visual Animated Character in a Photoreal Feature. So not bad for my first project, right? And I'm just going to end up talking about Ivan by showing you this, because it's true what they say. You do have a fuzzy, feel a fuzzy feeling when you see your names in the credits on the first time. It's a really special thing, and I can't wait for you guys to go through it. So the second film I worked at NPC was the big red dog called Clifford. Who has watched this one? Anyone? Oh, one, two, two. Great. I think it's still in some cinemas morning sessions, so if you have little ones in your family, take them because they're going to love it. I took my niece, she's nine, and she loved it. I worked on this only a few months, but still got the opportunity to work on some cool sequences, and I've compiled some shots of those sequences for you to see. Please note that these are final renders, because you will find out when you go into the industry that it might be hard for you to get the renders from your department, especially when you work on film and the film comes out 1 or 2 years after you worked on it, because by that time the studio already archived everything and nobody's going to go there to grab your renders for sure. So let's have a look.
Thank you.
Okay, so this film offered some different challenges to Ivan. We only have one CG character. Of course, it's big and red, but it's just one. But there's always loads of people around him and touching him and petting him because he's a big puppy, so of course. And this was filmed on location or on set, so no virtual production involved. But of course, to solve issues like eyelines and spacing of the actors and, of course, focus pulling, they had to have stand-ins, and Clifford had some of the best ones. Like, for example, this one. Imagine you're going for a run in Central Park and then suddenly you look to your left and there's that there. So this one has two puppeteers, but we could also have shots with the head stuck on a tripod or just one of the puppeteers running with a head, you know. It would vary. So in layout, we would have to replace, or basically put our character, our CG dog, on top of these ones as best as we could. Sometimes we would have some clean plates to clean the guys from the back. And we would have to roto-anim everyone that was crossing in front of Clifford, which would happen often. One fun fact about this is that actually the stand-in had two sizes, an 8-foot and a 10-foot tall. The 8-foot one was used indoors because they had to put it to door frames, and the 10-foot tall would be used on outside exteriors, just to give it a bit more scale. In layout, we had to make sure that we were using the right model for each shot and each sequence. So when this show was wrapping up, for layout. It was the end of the year, and NPC didn't have any new show starting until spring next year. It was a time that they needed compositors, and they needed effects artists and lighters, but they didn't need layout at the time, so they couldn't renew my contract. And this is something you guys may face when you start in the industry, that you'll have contracts based on the duration of a show, and when you finish, if there's no other shows, they will extend it. But let me tell you that it has never been a better time to join the industry, but now. During COVID times, all of the filming and shooting had stopped, and then they all restarted at the same time, along with many others, because of the streaming wars. So currently, VFX artists are actually having to say no to clients because they just reset limits, so I think you guys will be fine. But you know what didn't stop during lockdowns and restrictions and COVID times? Animation. 3D animation never stopped, and that's what I want to work on next. So I joined Jellyfish Pictures at the start of 2020 to work on DreamWorks' Spirits Untamed, and I still have to pinch myself that I actually worked on a DreamWorks project, because, you know, when you're a kid, you watch the films, but from there to actually working on the film for them, it's great. Please note that this spirit is not the same, the same one of the 2002? Spirit, the Stallion of Cimarron, is not the same. This one is his son that is going on new adventures. And the film is actually more a retelling of the Netflix series Spirit Untamed. Jellyfish was the vendor, and our team worked on 1,300 shots from assets to final delivery. It was the first time Jellyfish worked on the full-length feature animation, so it was a big deal, and everyone was super excited to work on it. So I'm just going to show you a short clip from the film, a sequence that I actually worked on, and is when our heroine, Lucky, meets Spirit.
What did I do?
as you guys can see, there was a whole herd of horses. And remember what I told you, that layout is in charge of seeing the continuity between the shots? So yeah, we spend a lot of hours on that, because this is is not the only sequence that had loads of horses. And we have to ensure that they were the right horses on the right shots, following one another. Sometimes we would have to reveal the horses after coming from animation, because sometimes an animator would just reset the model and suddenly you'd have the whole horses wrong. So it was a big part of our job there. We work directly with the layout department at DreamWorks Animation, because they were doing the rough layout. We received the cameras from them, but we often had to make adjustments and refine them or adapt them to our environment, because Jellyfish's final environment would be different than the one DreamWorks created very early on the pre-production stage. I joined the project when they were finishing working on the first sequence in layouts, and I've worked on every other sequence on the film. And it's very special when you're watching a film and you know there is, in one way or another, your fingerprint in all of the sequences, either because I did layouts or I did fixes on that. Halfway through production, I was promoted to lead because our lead layouts left. And this was a whole new challenge. I couldn't think just about my shots. I had to think about the team. And it's not easy when you are promoted from within the same team of artists, especially when they have someone to compare you to because he just left and he did an incredible job. So I did the best that I could. I continued my predecessor's incredible job. I improved on what I could, trying to keep the team spirits high. A team that I never met personally because we were in lockdown. So it was challenge upon challenge. But I loved it and I would do it again. One of the best things of being a lead is that I would be on the calls with the head of layouts in DreamWorks in LA. And he was amazing. He had decades of experience. He actually worked on the original Spirit in 2002. So I could just pick his brain a bit on how he thinks sequences. And the film has an amazing camera work created by him. What I want to show you next is a side-by-side of layout and final delivery shot. Jellyfish was kind enough to provide me a few, so you will be able to see what we worked on in layout and what the final looked like. So as you can see, our left side is layout, of course. Our sets are dressed down. Our horses don't have a mane or a tail, but composition-wise and camera-wise, it stays the same. Actually, in this project, animators couldn't change the cameras. If they needed to change the camera because of any animation choice, they would have to raise a ticket to layout, and then we would do it. So we were really in charge of the virtual cinematography here. We were really proud of the final result, especially because it was done within such a complicated year with everyone working remotely. So yeah, it was almost a dream come true for me. And now we've reached the present. I am now a visualization artist at the third floor. So in case you don't know, the third floor is one of the main providers of visualization services for film and TV. And I've been working with them for 1 year on a project, and unfortunately I can't talk about because it's under NDA. I can tell you it's a streaming series that will come out at the end of the year, but that's how far I can go. So I'm going to tell you what I do as a visualization artist that is also known as a shot creator at third floor. So some of you, I mean, I guess all of you will suspect you do previs. Yes, it's true, we do previs. And we already talked about it, but I'm going to expand on it. Previs is a 3D animation of the story transformed into shots and sequences. This is a real sandbox for the client to try ideas. And let me tell you that rejection of your shots is a sign of success in previs. It means that you tried something and it didn't work, and now the client won't have to spend time and money going on location with cast and crew trying and seeing that it doesn't work. So there's a lot of rejection involved, but it's never personal. It's just the way it is. It's a very collaborative project. You try something, it doesn't work. You try something again, and then it will work. But we will also do tech viz, that you might not know. That is a technical analysis that informs how the story can be physically shot. The third floor workflow actually stores all the technical information. Lens type, camera distance, camera speed, size of green screens, speed of vehicles, and this will all assist when they actually go on and film the shots. And we also do post-vis. This is actually a bit similar to what I used to do in layout. We combine the previous elements with the live-action photography to quickly preview the film before implementing the final visual effects. We do a lot of compositing work on this stage, either on Nuke or After Effects, depending on the project. So take that into consideration. There's also a skill that is very useful. Post-production will work as well as a blueprint for the visual effects studios to know what they have to do and to bid as well the project. The third floor also has a virtual production workflow, but unfortunately I haven't worked with it yet, so I won't be able to expand on it today. Maybe next time. I can't stop talking about the third floor without showing you their showreel, so you can see some of the cool projects we've worked on. Reached tips and advice part as promised. Thank you so much for waiting all this time. So I will start with a very important one. Networking. I know it's been hard these past 2 years with lockdowns and restrictions, but from now on, if possible, do attend related events to your area. Go there, interact with other people attending because it will probably be there to network as well, talk with the speakers. Have your showreel on your phone to show in case there's opportunities to receive feedback. Don't be too defensive if you hear bad feedback. And add all these people on LinkedIn to start building your network. I would advise you to, if you want to add someone, always add them with a little note. Just let them know where you met them that you would like to connect. For example, you can add me, but I would appreciate if you comes with a note introducing yourself and saying, I saw you at the industry week and I would love to connect, because some people don't accept just anyone. So it's good to know that you've seen them somewhere at least. And this led me to my second point, the importance of LinkedIn. For many years, I thought LinkedIn was not for artists, until I got my first job at MPC via LinkedIn. I never applied on a careers website. I reached out to the recruiter on LinkedIn. I never even had to send my CV. But funny enough, when I went to the interview, they had printed my LinkedIn in CV format. So he was going through everything that I had written on LinkedIn and asking me things about it. So it's very important, keep it up to date. describe what you did on your jobs or on your degrees and your courses, and do some posts as well. For example, you finish your final project, post there, write something about it, because sooner or later you'll start appearing on recruiters' timelines and they may reach out to it. Next one, showreels. Don't forget your references. So, of course, showreels, the requirements of showreel depends on departments, but something that I've always heard, heads of departments saying that they love to see references. And please, when you send showreels, be department focused. Don't just send a showreel with all the work you've done in your life and wait for the recruiter to decide where to put it, because they would just ignore it and put it on the side. So you should tailor it to some sort of department. And they want to see references. For example, you've modeled something, show your references for your model, or textures or effects if you're doing effects, or animation. Did you act a piece that you then animated? Put your acting there on the corner. Especially in VFX, everything is based on reality, so it's very important for them to see you can take hints from reality and build your stuff from there. Oh, also very important on the showreels, if you do group projects, don't forget to write what you did on each shot, and never take credit for someone else's work, because it will be discovered, and it might ruin your reputation. Be flexible. This has some applications. First one, as I told you, you might jump from studio to studio under the beginning of your career, and you need to be able to adapt very easily to the way the new studio works. Of course, pipelines are roughly the same, but they would have different processes, different tools, and you need to be able to adapt. Another thing as well is VFX is an evolving industry. Very often you'll hear about new tools and softwares joining the pipeline. If you think it's going to affect your job, start learning them. You have to evolve with the industry, or then you'll risk getting left behind. Be a team player. Okay, this is pretty self-explanatory, but you might think, I'm going to this studio, I'm just going to work on my shots and we'll be fine. Actually, no, there's a lot of brainstorming between the artists, and people don't have any problems of asking for help. So it's very important to be someone that is easy to work with, because you still work on a team. And also, the industry is very small, and a lot of jobs may come via recommendations. So if someone enjoyed working with you, higher are the chances of them to recommend you for the next job. Of course, don't be nice just because of that. Do it because it's the right thing to do, but take that into consideration. Last one, don't forget, we're all filmmakers, okay? So keep watching those films and series and learn from their visual storytelling, because it will be very important on your work. Especially in previs, we often discuss what was done before. For example, have a sequence, so what was done like that on other films, how can we do different, how can we do better? So yeah, keep watching films, keep being inspired. And with this, I've come to the end. Thank you so much for not leaving. Really appreciated this time with you guys. And if you have any questions, now is the time.
Thank you. Hello?
Yeah, thank you. That was really, really good. I love your tips as well. That's so cool. Who's got some questions for Sofia? Questions? Somebody have a question? Yay.
Hi. My question is, do you use procedural tools for previs or in general in your department?
So in previs, we use Maya to animate and assemble the shots. And then we are using After Effects to composite them. We have some tools that facilitate loads of processes, but we don't really have anything procedural. We do have a very extensive animation library that makes our job way easier and faster as well, because we have loads of walk cycles and actions already recorded from previous shows and assets as well.
Okay, so do you mostly reuse the assets?
No, not necessarily. For example, the show I'm working on, we have CG double for all the characters, and we have to build loads of environments from concept art. We might reuse, for example, we need a broom. Okay, so let's go to our attic, is what we call it, and just grab a broom. We don't have to do a broom from scratch. But environments, we always follow as the concept art to build them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Yay.
If you were like trying to tailor a showreel specifically to work in layout, how would you best sort of show that off? Would it be with like final shots or more sort of like screen grabs of how you assembled all the different components?
Yeah, I would say yes. It would be very important to have camera movements on your shots. So for example, even if you've, model and texture something and you put it on the plate, do a nice camera movement on it, have a tracked shot, is also, I would say, is very important. And do set dressing, for example. Just get a room, do set dressing of the room, a nice camera movement showing the room, tracking shot. Although I didn't have on my showreel, but sometimes it's important to show animation skills as well. So if you could show some animation on there, it will be good as well.
More questions? You guys are quiet today. Well, has anyone got any more? No? Cool. We can just thank Sofia for her time then. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
And you. You can go now. B-Dog.